Okay, welcome back to the Java track. We have now Thorsten Ferner that is going to talk a little bit about his dreams with Java. And well, Thorsten is one of our key contributors. He does a lot of sponsoring and replying to emails and stuff. So really great he's giving a talk today.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, I want to talk a little bit about the Java packaging nightmare and what is so special about packaging Java or software written in Java. My topics will be first a bit about the motivation of the talk, about the history of free Java, the current state of Java in Debian. We have already heard something, but I will give you a rough overview. Then the biggest part will be the problems in upstream packaging and some proposed solutions, how that can be fixed. And a short slide about packaging with Apache Maven in addition to the Java helper. Questions and answers. But I won't talk about the programming language Java or any details about the programming language. There's nothing wrong in the language itself. It's more or less the open source community of the Java world. That's a bit different than what we know from other languages. The motivation for my post was a blog post by Vincent, which is even a contributor to Debian, with the title "The Java Packaging Nightmare." I don't expect you to read all the text now. I've highlighted some of the most important pieces. And he writes about the problem of the upstream code that he does have to disable parts of it to get it compiled at all. That's a lot of work to find and build the dependencies of some code and the dependencies of the dependencies and their dependencies. So it's quite a recursive approach to get it fixed. The major problem behind that is that Java is distributed often in binary platform independent format, in a binary platform independent format, which makes it very easy to copy the jar files and to use them, but that's not acceptable for Debian main. We cannot just copy binary jar files into our main distribution. We must build everything from source, we must check every source package for correct licensing, and so on. Yeah. Some of the history of free Java. The Sun JDK was non-free software for most of its time, since it was released in 1995. But a lot of free software has been already written in the past. Something like Tomcat, which was released in 1999, JBoss, Eclipse, which was released in 2001, Hibernate, just to name some of the free Java project that exists for some time. There have been several alternative Java development kits been written, and also development kits, runtime environments, and the virtual machines. Some of them are Cafe, GZJ, which has been released in 1999 too, quite old. ClassPath, the Eclipse compiler. All of them got better and better with time, but never as good as the original Sun Java stuff. So we always had the problem that some older code could be built easily with the free alternatives, but newer code always started using features from Sun's implementation, and that's why we always had the problem building newer code for Debian. Everything changed with the relicensing of the Java, of Sun's Java development kit in 2006 under the GPL and as with the name OpenJDK. It wasn't directly usable for us. Do you have a question?
I just wanted to point out that at the end of 2006, Sun announced the choice of GPL as the license for OpenJDK, but the code was not available until Java 1 in 2007. Okay. And yeah. I'll add that Gentoo packaged OpenJDK within 3 hours of the code drop, And the first build of Ice-T was within 48 hours of the first code drop.
Yeah.
The other thing I would like to say was this article, the Java Trap, by Richard Stallman, that kind of put a hold on free software and Java at the very beginning. Yeah. That's fairly relevant to free software and Java. The release of the OpenJDK kind of opened up that, stopped that issue.
Yeah. As you already told us, the ISD project started in 2007 and submitted additional patches and the build system which we are using today. Even if our packages are called OpenJDK, but they are using OpenJDK with the ISD patches. And we got some free licenses, core libraries for the Java Enterprise world through the Glassfish relicensing. Which happened a bit earlier, I think. Some other projects like Apache Geronimo, they provide similar core libraries. Most of them are important to as build dependencies for other stuff. So even if you don't know what Java Enterprise is, it might be still important. Such libraries might be still important for other tools and libraries to get them packaged. So. The current state in Debian is that the Java packaging team is maintaining more than 500 source packages today. And there are other people maintaining Java packages, but I haven't counted them. It's quite growing, or fast growing. I think we were about 400 source packages at the beginning of this year. So we are now more than 100 more. Our toolchain is in a good shape, at least on our major architectures. We have some popular packages in Debian, Tomcat, Eclipse, the Jarjuk, Jukebox as a desktop application, and some libraries like Hibernate, and some more stuff, but I think that are the most important ones, or the most popular ones. We have no Java Enterprise application server. But some core libraries from Glassfish, JBoss, and Geronimo. We have no major web application as far as I know. Something like Web Library is not packaged. It's quite horrible to get all those libraries and plugins built. We have a good cooperation with Ubuntu, but not with other Linux distributions as far as I know. And we have almost no interest by upstream developers, except in some cases like Tomcat, maybe Eclipse, I don't know. In most cases, from all those more than 500 packages, almost nobody of the upstream maintainers is really interested in Debian.
Those 500 packages, or are you talking about
that? Yeah, across all those 500 packages. I think if you have contact to 10 upstream, I think it's quite a lot.
Why do you think that is? Why is that so consistent across so many different Java packages?
In the case of mine, they just don't consider Linux a very interesting target for their work. And so, it just doesn't seem important to them. One of the upstreams I've got, though, has been wonderfully responsive when I had questions for them. But, as long as they're not specific to things that are platform oriented.
One of the things that I found when we talked to that I found is that Java upstreams basically are of the opinion, well, I'm writing in a platform independent language, the jars on my website, people can download it. Why do I need to do all of this perceived by them extra work, because they aren't thinking forward in terms of how this actually helps them in the long run in order to support your specific thing? If the people want it on Linux, then they can go and download it, and they just need to pull the jar off the website. There are a lot of upstreams as well who don't think about all licensing issues and what have you. They just bundle stuff in a jar and then leave it there.
Yeah. So response.
In some cases, the upstream even doesn't want to have the issue of Debian stable, that stays so stable. And they say, no, we want people to download it from our website, blah, blah, blah. So they're even hostile about the idea of us packaging stuff.
Yeah. And response to bug reports is quite low. If you get ever an answer, it takes long. And so we often have to fix Java code by ourselves. But even cases where it's probably much easier for the upstream developer to do that. But because we do not get any answer.
To try to understand kind of the environment that makes it so that there's so little interest in doing this, thinking about a company like LifeRay that has quite a few people working in the company and a pretty active community, and the install is actually pretty easy if you just install LifeRay. What is it that is sort of the explanation within Debian as to why something like LifeRay, such a vibrant project like that, wouldn't have a package, wouldn't have a lot of upstream support? I don't mean that as an invective. It's, you know, try constructive.
In case of LifeRay, I know that they are not even interested in getting patches or something. So that's not really an open source community, but that might be a different problem compared to other. LifeRay is a project that, for them, open source is marketing. It's a marketing argument. They don't, I have seen that they don't even accept pitches and developments from outside.
Yeah, I actually know those guys, and it's not a marketing gimmick. They really are committed.
Yeah, I've seen it otherwise. The patches from our company haven't been accepted at all. Not even with questions how we could improve them. They just don't integrate external stuff.
It sounds like some of the common threads here, apart from sometimes a lack of interest or motivation for free software in general, but for Linux as a platform, for Debian as a platform, it sounds like, in particular because it's so easy to install already, as you say, what value does the Debian packaging add from the upstream's perspective? From Debian's perspective, a lot, but.
So that almost seems like a marketing or education task for the Debian community, because I can assure you that the people at LifeRay are not cynically calling themselves open source. Maybe they have operational problems, so it just seems like a little bit of introspection here would go a long way.
That's possible, but I don't think anyone actually is attributing malice here at all. I mean, that's not necessary to sort of explain the disconnect. My observation is just, I think you're hitting a lot of this on the head, Matt. A lot of it has to do really with this notion that, what value is this really adding? And if you are someone who lives in Debian space and you understand how wonderful life is, if you have a strong dependency system and things that are carefully integrated under a consistent policy, the every time you get anywhere near Java things, you just immediately have this revulsive reaction of, oh my God, this is all so broken all the time. And I think if you're coming from the Java universe, you're accustomed to sort of, well, I just grab all these things and put them here and they all just work together, and why do I need all of this other stuff that I don't completely understand? And it's just it's a worldview disconnect. I don't have to believe there's any intentional malice or anything like that there.
And it might be in a case like this upstream, if you have a personal connection, that can go a long way. Just to say, hey, people are very interested in LifeRay, and the way that they do this is to have a very clean, strong dependency system. It actually might make the product healthier, and if you are really wanting to go beyond the marketing of open source, but really want to integrate, let's have a discussion about it.
Yeah, I think if there's some material that the Debian community has put together, really building the strong case, in a sort of a way that can be replicated across these various upstreams. I don't mean to single LifeRay out in particular. Maybe that would be something that a lot of people could do, just take that material to say, here are the advantages, boom, 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 and maybe even with some case studies or something. If something like that existed, that might be something that a lot of companies could be presented with and get more participation like that.
I think it's useful to have that kind of information written down in a in
organized,
a
yes,
but
that's right.
I, but as was already said, I think a personal connection there counts for a lot more than a document as well.
I agree, but having a personal connection with a document is obviously the best, because then it's something that anyone, you can replicate. Anytime anyone has any good connection, you can say, here's this thing, and you don't have to have an amateurish case built for why it's such a great idea. You can have a collaborative effort put together with like sound business reasons, sound practical reasons, and then have a person who happens to have a connection but may not be an expert at doing the sell of why it's such a good idea to do it, be able to hand off something that really is very carefully thought through from a number of perspectives.
Yeah. Take advantage of the opportunity that we have to work on that. And I apologize for continuing to derail your presentation, but since we do have an opportunity here, maybe with this project in particular, I'd ask two questions. The first would be, you know, if we asked people in the LifeRay project, you know, why would Debian packaging your software be valuable to you? What would they say? And the second question would be, could you ask them that? And, you know, because it can be hard to develop materials like you're talking about, sort of from the inside out. When you know we're swimming in this Debian sea and we don't know that we're in it, whereas getting that outside perspective can make it easier.
The other part is there've been lots of presentations given over time in lots of different forums about why a strongly dependency managed distribution of software is a good thing. The problem is none of that is specific to the Java experience, and it's clearly not reaching folks in that community. So the disconnect here is it's that same sort of, we're sitting on opposite sides of the river, and you know, how do we get across it to work with each other? As I sit here going, well, why is it my job to convince them that doing things better is better? And on some level, figuring out what the sort of mutual motivation is to actually come up with a more targeted piece of communication that would actually resonate with that audience is where the challenge is.
I'm sure I've read in the Debian Wiki a document on what are the benefits to upstreams to working with Debian. That document, I'm 99% sure has been written. I'm sure I've read it. I think it's just who's going to connect the people at LifeRay or wherever to the documents that Debian already has.
There's a pattern in the Java community which tells us that there's something different, a different need that needs to be addressed here beyond.
I mean, but this isn't hugely different from the Perl CPAN versus Debian packaging. I mean, it's not the first time we've run into this.
Let's continue. Let the speaker continue.
Oh, Thorsten, you'd actually like to talk some more?
Let's continue. I just used LifeRay as an example that we don't have major web apps in Debian. Yes, but it would be nice to have it. Sure. Okay. About some details about our toolchain, our runtime, our current toolchain runtime. OpenJDK is integrated with the IST patches, and it's our default JDK since the last stepconf on most Linux architectures. It provides several virtual machines, the Sun hotspot virtual machine, where the port is available, the Zero interpreter, and the experimental Shark virtual machine, and the Kakao virtual machine from IST. We are using GZJ JDK on FreeBSD, heard in the Linux HPPA platform. We have the IST browser applet in Squeezy, but not in Stable. And we have the non-free Xun, JDK from Xun, but it's not used for packaging as far as I know. No longer used as for packaging. We have used it in the past for packaging and contrib, but I think all of them have been moved to main with using OpenJDK or default JDK as a build, as a JDK. We have several packaging tools, Java Helper, Arndt, Maven, and some homemade makefiles or scripts. That are the tools that build or that compile Java code into class files, and we have some Debian-specific stuff that modifies the Java files or installs them or whatever, something like CDBS, several Maven helper packages, three of them, and Eclipse helper, which is part of Java helper, but a bit specific for the Debian packaging. Okay, the Debian Free Software Guidelines, we have, I think, two problems with Java code. The first is free redistribution. We often find undocumented licenses or licenses that don't allow redistribution in Java code. If you look closer, that must be removed for Debian main, or it must be rewritten or replaced by something new. Or we find binary jars without source code. That's the second problem. Sometimes we have discrimination against fields of endeavor. Sun has released in the past source code that couldn't be used in nuclear facilities. It's a bit, but they have fixed most of their licenses. So today you don't find a lot of code that uses this clause anymore. And there is some, in the JSON library, there's the famous should be used for good but not for evil clause, which is just stupid. That are the most violations of the DFSG we see in the Java world. Yeah, licenses of source code are incorrectly documented, I have already told. Sometimes you only find binary-only jar files and no reference where the source can be found or where was it downloaded in the first place, or some source control system or some address for a source control system. There are no license or copyright information in the binary jars. And they are sometimes obviously non-free, if you could look a bit closer. Missing modularization is another problem. I will come to it at the next slide, or a later slide. The official Maven repository has no notion of a source package, so you can find a lot of binaries, but you cannot find out easily if several binaries come from the same source. It's not, just not, cannot find it out. You can find sometimes source jars, jars with source code, but no build system. How useful. You often cannot build them in a simple way like with Java Helper because dependencies are missing or something like that. Or the several source jars come from the same source tree, but they are packaged and scattered about the Maven repository, so quite unusable. The dependency handling in Maven is not usable for Debian, not fully usable for Debian. And we often find code duplication. Some license failures I have found in the past. The JBoss web is a fork of, or more or less a fork of Tomcat. There's a top-level license file that mentions LGPL version 3, but most of the code is actually an Apache license or CDL or GPL license from some Sun code as part of the, so it just declares a wrong license in the top-level directory. JRuby, the release 1.5.1, shipped with a binary file Constantine jar, where no source could be found anywhere in the web during the time of the release. This has been fixed now. It's now available on github.com. But during the release, it was not available. And Hibernate ships the Java Persistence 2.0 API, and this API cannot redistribute it in Debian main because no license is granted for distributing the specification to third parties. Fortunately, we can use the Geronimo implementation of the Java Persistent API from the Apache Software Foundation. Missing modularization. Building modules or depending on modules during build time is quite easy in the good old C and C++ world. We have tools like autoconf, automake, package config, and you can run configure with --- enable feature A or disable feature B. You can use package config on your system to find out if some package is available or not, and if it's available, which arguments you need to build a program that depends on this feature. The same is can be used with CMake. It's a bit different syntax, but more or less you can switch on or switch off features. But such a concept is almost non-existent in the Java world. You have often no way to switch on or off some feature in your software, even if you're packaging a multi-module system like Hibernate has 10 submodules or so. There are some technologies could be used. In Maven, the profiles could be used, but they are not very popular. They can configure modules to build, submodules to build, and or some plugins. You can switch on or switch off plugins or configure them. And they can be activated by properties. So you could just set a properties to switch on a profile or switch off a profile. But almost nobody uses this functionality here. In Debian, source patching is the best practice. We are just removing parts of the source or changing the build system during build time. But it's not really best practice. It's that what we are using. Here is some example, some XML snippet from Hibernate, the POM XML file, where such activation, module activation is really done. What it does, if the property disable JDK 6 modules is not set to true, it builds the entity manager in the GDBC for testing modules. That's quite good, but it's an example you find very seldom in code. So we can just set disable the property disable to the JDK6 modules if you don't want to build the submodules because they are maybe too problematic or so. I would wish that we would have more such options in the upstream build systems, but they almost do not exist. Another option would be to exclude individual Java files from building because they depend on some non-packaged library. That can be done in Maven quite easily with configuring the Maven compiler plugin in the way which it excludes. And such it could be put into a profile and activated by a property as well. What we do not have in the Java world is a preprocessor like CPP. What we could do is filtering source filtering before compiling the source, but that's a bit awkward. I think I haven't seen a package where we use source filtering. What you will see often is excluding some Java file from building because it just does not build with our build dependencies in main. Yeah, I've already told you that in the Maven repository, we often have a problem to find the source code for some jar or POM file. This is strange because the POM XML file already has elements for that could be used for more information for some metadata about the package. Or they could just use some XML comment to put the information inside. My proposal for upstream would be to put in every POM XML file either the source information or a reference where I can find the source information. And what we need in Debian is the name of the package, a short description, a homepage link, access to the source control system, to the issue tracker. The copyright holder would be interesting. What you see here is the name of the elements that already exist in the POM XML schema. It could be used for that. They don't have any element for the copyright holder, but you could use a comment. And the license, there's even a license section. Of course, it wouldn't make sense to duplicate this information every binary module. That's why I would suggest that they either use the parent element to reference the source POM or mention the source POM in an XML comment again. So the advantage would be that whenever we find such a binary jar, the POM file is embedded in the binary jar by Maven, we could find either the reference to the source POM or all the information we need directly into the XML file. That would be quite nice. And that would a question we could directly ask upstream developers if they would change their POM XML files in a way that they become useful to us. And of course, an upstream developer should not only check their own source code, they should check all their direct dependencies too, if they are correct. And Okay, code duplication is a problem which is which we can find quite often, even in the Java world. There's a nice wiki page in the Fedora wiki about that. It even references the Debian policy, so it's worth reading that. I found four ways for embedding code in Java libraries. The first one is just a plain source copy or of some foreign source code. This is easy to handle. We can just remove it and package it separately and reference the separately packaged file in the build process. Another way is including a modified copy of the foreign source code. This is awkward because it opens all maintenance problems like security updates and such things. There's only one way. Just ask upstream if they can merge it with the upstream of the foreign code, or we could build such source dApps, dApps that are just containing source code and build depend on those source dApps and patch them during build time. This is, I'm aware of one package where such exporting is done, and yeah. The advantage would be that we could, if there's a security problem or any important update, we could just rebuild the Debian package and we would get the newest version embedded into the binary package. Embedding content of other jar files can be found quite often because jar files are just jar files are just zip files, so they are unpacked and added to the to other jar files. That happens very often, and that's simply stupid to do. It would be much better to put the original class files into the class path and use the classes. Either we change the package to not embed it, the foreign jar files, or just rebuild them if necessary. It's not a big security problem or something, because just rebuilding the package will just re-embed the newest version of all the dependencies, so it's easier to fix. Sometimes we see build processes that include or embed modified content of other jar files. That's really the worst thing we can see. They're using tools like JarJar to rewrite the class hierarchy. With Java packages, now it becomes a bit difficult. Java packages is now means the directory where the classes are located in Java. It's not a Debian package, it's a Java package. And we see cases where such org.objectweb.asm classes are just moved into the jruby.objectweb.asm tree, and this is harder to detect, and we will get embedded code with another name, and which is hard to fix. I think we should try to find such cases by just comparing the name of the classes itself without the package prefix. But yeah, it will take some time to do such an analysis. But I think we should do it in Debian to avoid such code duplication. Okay, we could just remove some tools like JarJar, but I think that wouldn't be the correct way to handle that. I think. Oh, okay.
You got me? I was wondering, you were saying that for security updates, it's easy to just rebuild the package and embed everything again. How easy is it to build a package that's got a bug in its own code and use all the versions that you used the first time you built it so that you're not changing everything else in the package?
No, I was talking about you have a foreign package A and another package B, and B embeds everything from A.
Exactly. So B has a security flaw in its own code.
Okay.
And it was built for a stable, and you want to do a stable release and find the old version that happened to be on the day that you built it last time. Where do you find it?
It would be horrible for stable. Yeah. So even for for stable, it would
that
be
sort of thing is the reason why we've got this disconnect.
We would need a lot of bin NMUs for fixing such things, and it's easier on unstable, but it would be more difficult for stable. Okay. Now I have a slide about using Apache Maven for packaging in Debian. Maven is a build tool and a repository. We must keep that in mind that now I'm talking about the build tool Maven primarily. It is still quite new in Debian, but we have now many of the artifacts that are the packages called in Maven language that are shipping the POM files now in the Debian package, which is required for using them. For Maven, or which is required by Maven to be used. But ARNT is still the mostly used packaging tool in the Java world, often in combination with CDBS. But sometimes Java Helper is becoming more important in DH. We are using the Maven offline mode during build time. Maven itself downloads just everything from the Maven central repository during build time, but we switch off this online mode for Debian, building Debian packages. We are setting up our own Maven POM repository in the user share Maven repo path. So we can access, so whenever we install a Debian package that ships a POM file, we get another artifact into the Maven repo repository, and we can use this offline Maven repository for building other Maven-based packages, and that's the way we are doing it in Debian. We don't access any external repositories. We must pre-process the POM XML files because they aren't directly usable or the dependency handling is not directly usable. Or sometimes we need to patch out complete artifacts or plugins that are used by the upstream developers, but that aren't needed for the Debian build. Everything is explained in the Maven repository specification. I think we should put it at some time in the Java policy, at least as an addendum or. And we have three helper packages for Maven. The first one is the Maven repo helper. This helper will just install the POM files and the jar files into the correct location, creating symlinks and doing the pre-process step. But it does not require Maven to build any package. So we could still use either ARNT or Java Helper to build a package and use the Maven repo helper just to install the POM file and to pre-process the POM file to comply with the repository specification. The tool to really build Debian packages in Maven is the Maven Debian Helper, the last tool. That's a wrapper around Maven that just calls Maven away or that just switches on the offline mode and it calls the Maven repo helper to pre-process the POM file. So most of the stuff is quite automatic, so really short rules files, and the difference to Java Helper is that Maven is used to build the package. One advantage of Maven is that the directory structure is always the same in all packages, in all upstream packages. You always find the source code in the SRC directory or in the SRC/Java directory, if it's Java source code. And compiled code is put into a target directory. So the directory structure is always the same, which is quite nice. So we can use other build tools to build Maven packages without Maven. And so this is done with the Maven ARNT helper. This helper uses ARNT to package Maven. Or to build Maven It uses ARN to build those packages that are using Maven upstream. We have used this helper to bootstrap all those Maven thing because it's too difficult. You need Maven to build Maven packages, and that's why we have introduced this ARN helper, which can use ARN to build the basic Maven parts. Do we have a micro somewhere?
I heard someone say at one point having XML files configure complicated build logic is very yucky, and I agree. So I was wondering if anyone here had reached out to people at Gradle, because Gradle is being used by some bigger projects now and lets you do some fairly sophisticated things. So I'm wondering what the relationship between Debian and the whole build infrastructure thing is, and the Gradle team, if any.
We haven't packaged Gradle yet. Nobody has done the task. The motivation behind the Maven Debian helper stuff is that there are a lot of upstream packages that are using Maven, and I think in most cases it makes sense to use the upstream build system with slight modifications, the pre-processing stuff, but with, more or less we are using the upstream build system, and I think that's often the easiest way, because we want to, sure. Sometimes the Java code is generated from something else we don't know, or the test code is run in some special way we don't know. That's why we are using the upstream build system is the most easiest way to build a package, to build a more complex package. I agree with Matthew that if you have a very simple library, Java helper will do it, but if it's more complex with submodules and everything,
I was specifically referring to the ant Maven ant helper, where you had a structure that was known and you didn't feel like using Maven to build it.
Yeah, if there it was used to bootstrap also the Maven infrastructure. Yeah.
Right, and I'm just suggesting that Gradle would be an interesting alternative.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, I haven't looked at it.
It's pretty awesome.
I know that Groovy is using Gradle, I think.
And Grails has moved to it as well.
Yeah. Okay, I think. I think it was even the last slide. Something happened to my notebook. So, I'm open for questions.
I was saying that with respect to reaching out to upstream maintainers, we can try to get the Debian publicity team involved and try to make some... The main thing we should be offering these people are bug reports and even patches and bug fixes.
Yeah, might be an option. I think we should try to cooperate more with other Linux distributions, because they probably have the same problem as we have. And if we... if there are more than two Linux distributions taking care of Java packages, I think upstream will react to the requests. But that's, we need to find a way to get in contact with Java maintainers from other distributions. That would be an interesting thing.
Questions?
Much.
Not a question, but it sounded like you had stimulated some pretty good discussion around trying to solve some of these problems. Might it be a good idea to arrange a BOF or something to follow that up and agree some actions?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Come.